Lately on my channel, I've been talking about a lot of death metal bands. Well, I think it's about time that I review my favorite death metal band. Bolt Thrower. A sign of a great death metal band is charisma, where their music sounds awesome, likable, and inspiring. Bolt Thrower is the best example of this. Their music is gruff and visceral, yet masculine and energizing. They are consistent, a trait that they are renowned for, yet creative, with little variation in the quality of their albums, and yet an underrated amount of variety and nuance. They bring the riffs, and yet they are also appreciable as sonic art. Their lyrics are fantastic, and so is their songwriting and musicianship. And I haven't even mentioned the iconic vocals of Carl Willits. Most of all, they have a unique sound, combining melody and slower tempos with the harshness of grindcore, a ratio that would slowly change over the course of their 8 albums. Although they are not with us anymore, Bolt Thrower are one of death metal's most immortal legends. Bolt Thrower began in 1986 in Coventry, England, in a pub. Its original founders were Gavin Ward and Barry Thompson, Bolt Thrower's 2 guitarists. Andrew Whale was their drummer, and Alan West was their original vocalist for a time. And they made a series of demos, none of which I will cover, as most of that material would end up being re-recorded on their first album. By 1988, they would get Joe Bench on bass and their chauffeur, Carl Willits, on vocals, replacing Alan West. Their original intent was to play thrashy hardcore punk, but they took things a bit further and started exploring grindcore and death metal, much like their contemporaries, Napalm Death. With their classic lineup established, they got lucky and were favored by the BBC DJ John Peel, who helped them get a record deal. In 1988, their first album was recorded and released. In battle, there is no law, is a raw vehicle of energy. This album is simply awesome. The production is admittedly very raw, but that adds to this album's character, especially considering the buzzsaw guitar tone, which is never a downside to me. The riffs are fantastic, being simple and to the point, but distinct enough to be memorable. And Carl's vocals sound absolutely furious. My favorite part of the album, however, is the intense rhythmic drumming, which most explains its moshability. It's only a half hour long, so it ends before it gets monotonous, and each song is about equal in quality, so it's a very easy listen. As for the genre dispute, I think this album is death grind, similar to Terrorizer or Repulsion. The overall sound is very grindy, but the riffs themselves are death metal. My only two gripes are that the vocals are too quiet, so Carl takes a back seat here, and that Bolt Thrower's signature catchiness isn't at all present here. Despite that, this is one of the best death grind albums of all time and a fantastic debut. Bolt Thrower would only go up from here, but in the meantime, In Battle There Is No Law is an 8 out of 10. Their one album record deal ended, but it was just the boost they needed. Earache Records, a major player within extreme metal, picked them up, and they got to work on their second album. Then, another opportunity found them. Well known are Bolt Thrower's lyrical themes. They deal with war and combat, but also Warhammer. Hell, even the name Bolt Thrower is a reference to Warhammer 40k. Games Workshop, Warhammer's developer, approached them and had an album cover produced. Then, in 1989, it released Realm of Chaos. Well, In Battle is an absolute catfight of an album, its production masks a lot of Bolt Thrower's magic, and they were still yet to unlock a lot of their songwriting sophistication. Realm of Chaos, however, with its bigger budget and vaster creativity, is Bolt Thrower Unleashed. This is a monster of an album, and one of the greatest OSDM albums. Compared to its predecessor, Realm of Chaos has much better and heavier production, more skillful instrumentation, and clearer, fuller vocals. Most notably, the riffs are more melodic, complex, and sludgier. The result is songwriting that is highly memorable due to the catchier and slower riffs. There are still frequent grind sections, but generally this is a standard death metal album rather than a death grind album. As for the vocals, Carl has a deep, raspy, and powerful voice that sounds very pained yet energetic. Simply put, his vocals are perfect for Bolt Thrower, and he is one of the best vocalists in all of death metal. My complaint with this album is that it is backloaded. Although there are no weak songs here, the second half is easily the better half. The best riffs are all in the last four songs in particular. Lost Souls Domain is the exception to this. Featuring tempo changes and lots of riff variety, it is the best song on the album's first half. The best song on the album overall is Bolt Thrower's fan favorite, World Eater, one of the best death metal songs of all time. The riffing and tempo changes it contains are legendary, and most iconic is the contrast between its grindy rhythm guitar and melodic leads. The last three songs, Drowned in Torment, Realm of Chaos, and Prophet of Hatred, are the album's cool down, emphasizing its sludgier and catchier side and easing off on the grind pedal. Ultimately, Realm of Chaos is a bit lopsided, but is still an amazing album as a result of its fantastic riffs, impeccable production, and the contrast between grind and melody. Realm of Chaos gets a 9 out of 10. Realm of Chaos caused Bolt Thrower to become a major player in death metal. After touring for it, they recorded its follow-up. In 1990, War Master was released. War Master is perhaps the album that is most representative of what Bolt Thrower sounds like. Gone are the grind elements, and instead is their signature sound. Sludgy, compositionally sophisticated riffs, rough vocals, and restrained, slower drumming. Bolt Thrower are very comfortable here, settled into their niche. So why is it that this is my least favorite Bolt Thrower album? I honestly don't know. It's not a bad album by any means. The whole album is enjoyable, but it just isn't as enjoyable as the other albums. Sometimes I am just at a loss for words when trying to justify my preferences, so I won't try, and this is one of those times. It's just that I don't like this album as much. There is one identifiable problem, however, and that is the production. It lacks the expert mixing of Realm of Chaos and is kind of a wall of sound. The drums are thuds and the guitar playing is a buzzy wall of sound. I suppose it could be worse, but this album sounds kind of awful. At least In Battle's rawness is atmospheric. There's one other feature which I must mention. Cenotaph, the best song on the album, begins a series of songs that would periodically appear on their following albums, that each contain the same intro riff. That's a small but interesting feature of Bolt Thrower. In short, War Master is Bolt Thrower's misstep. In isolation, it's a decent album, but it doesn't do anything better than any other Bolt Thrower album. 6 out of 10. After a period of touring, Bolt Thrower released their fourth album in 1992, The Fourth Crusade. The Fourth Crusade is a bit of an oddity in Bolt Thrower's discography, as it doesn't exactly fit the progression of the rest of their albums. It is more polished and melodic than what came before it, but it is the only Bolt Thrower album to really dabble in doom metal. The tempos are slower and many of the songs are arguably death doom. As a fan of doom metal, it should come as no surprise that this is one of my favorite Bolt Thrower albums. In addition to the juicy riffs, the production is incredible, with lots of atmosphere and one of the best guitar tones in death metal history. Bolt Thrower, in general, have amazing sounding guitars, but this is probably where it peaked. The bass is also very obvious, and the drums sound nice too. The doomier sound combined with the heavy atmosphere gives this album a massive, bombastic sound, which I adore. The best song on the album is without a doubt the first one, the title track. Its slow, brooding, and ominous main riff is one of Bolt Thrower's most famous, and it's so good that it basically carries the entire song. Embers, the second song to have the Cenotaph riff, is very awesome, and Where Next to Conquer, being the catchy groove song of the album, simply slaps. Spearhead is Bolt Thrower's longest song, with the album version being nearly 7 minutes, and is more doomy goodness, probably the second best song on the album. At the end is Through the Ages, a subdued doom metal song with spoken word vocals about various wars, a very nuanced way to end the album. In between these highlights is more songs, all of high quality. As a consequence of the slower tempos, this album is Bolt Thrower's longest. At over 53 minutes, it does test my patience at times. That being my only complaint, The Fourth Crusade is a fantastic and oddly relaxing album. There are no weak moments, and it contains some of Bolt Thrower's best songs and arguably their best production. 9 out of 10. Later that year, the Spearhead EP was released, containing an extended version of Spearhead, bringing it up to 9 minutes. In my opinion, that is the superior version. Also contained is a song from The Fourth Crusade and a couple other tracks from its sessions. It's worth a listen if you're a fan. 2 years later, Bolt Thrower released their final album with their classic lineup, 1994's For Victory.
This LP is going to be like the most sort of in-your-face stuff, really, isn't it? Sort of like a lot of the LPs that we've done before have been slightly slower than what we're actually playing them live. But this one, you know, it's in your face, and I think it's going to be like the most powerful one that we've made tonight.
For Victory is basically a synthesis of the two albums before it. There is the groove and doom and the atmospheric production of The Fourth Crusade, combined with the visceral grind, metaphorically speaking, of War Master. The result is a surprisingly cinematic sounding album, one that truly sounds like war and combat, making for a badass listening experience. This album, going into the second half of Bolt Thrower's discography, also marks a shift in lyrical themes. Previously, the lyrics either dealt with historical warfare or Warhammer. Going forward, the lyrics reflect modern wars, especially the world wars. This change would be reflected in the album covers as well. Another thing to note is that this album is just under 40 minutes, so it is pleasantly concise. There isn't really any noticeable flaws with this album either. It's very consistent and well executed. I actually consider this to be one of the weaker Bolt Thrower albums. However, that is just the fault of the other albums being even better than it, as I have nothing bad to say about For Victory. Lastly, the three best songs are without a doubt the more progressive title track, the punkish Lest We Forget, which has some of Carl's most savage vocals, and the very epic album closer, Armageddon Bound, which is full of adrenaline. Overall, For Victory is an awesome album that has everything Bolt Thrower are liked for. 8 out of 10. After Bolt Thrower's fifth album, two of their members left, for the same reason. Andrew Whale and Carl Willits found that their professional and personal lives were not able to coexist, so they gracefully left. Andrew Whale was replaced with a 17-year-old Martin Kearns, who left in 1997 without appearing on Bolt Thrower's next album. We will be hearing more of him, however. Replacing him is Alex Thomas, just famous enough to have a Wikipedia page. As for Bolt Thor's new vocalist, a similar thing happened. One of death metal's greatest vocalists was replaced by another one of death metal's greatest vocalists, Martin Van Drunen of Pestilence. Alas, as cool as a Bolt Thor album with him would have been, he left before that could happen, as he did not feel a part of the band or comfortable on stage. Heading into the studio for another album, Carl came back temporarily to provide vocals. In 1998, this album was released and is titled Mercenary.
I heard that there's a new album on the way, right?
Right, yeah, it was signed to Metal Blade, going in the studio on October the 1st to start recording, and it's just what Bolt Thor fans want. There's nothing out of the extraordinary, it's just Bolt Thor 100%.
Mercenary begins the last stretch of Bolt Thrower's discography. These last three albums are more groovy and more melodic, and feature a slower, more repetitive, and cleaner sound, the degree of which would increase from album to album. As for Mercenary in particular, it's certainly good, but it doesn't impress me as much. It's basically Bolt Thrower being Bolt Thrower, which is never a bad thing, but Mercenary isn't a masterpiece. The riffs are good, and the songs are consistent. The production, instrumentals, vocals, it's all up to Bolt Thrower's standard, but there's sort of a dryness that this album has that I can't just put my finger on. Maybe it's that the drumming is lacking in energy and technicality, or maybe it's the lack of atmosphere, or perhaps Carl's vocals being a little too low in the mix. There isn't any glaring issue, just some little things that you could use tweaking, but this album just lacks Bolt Thrower's usual sharpness, I guess. The best song on the album, without a doubt, is No Guts, No Glory, which has an epic chorus and lots of energy. The other highlights are the title track, Powder Burns, which is the third song with the Cenotaph riff, and the album closer, Sixth Chapter. Those are also a cut above the rest. In conclusion, Mercenary is a very enjoyable album, but the only Bolt Thrower album it's better than is War Master. 7 out of 10. After Mercenary, Bolt Thrower had no choice but to recruit a new singer. Carl Willits is hard to replace, but by getting Martin Van Drunen, they proved that they could do it well. So they did. This time with Benediction's former frontman Dave Ingram. Alex Thomas also left, so Martin Kearns returned and would be their drummer for the next decade. Heading into the new millennium, they released their 7th album, 2001's Honor, Valor, Pride. Is the sole Bolt Thrower album without Carl Willits, and the album considered to be Bolt Thrower's weakest? Well, first off, it's not. I really don't understand the dismissal of this album. It's one of Bolt Thrower's very best. In fact, I'd even say it's one of the most underrated death metal albums of all time. It's goddamn fantastic. And secondly, Dave Ingram was a fantastic replacement. His vocals are very similar to Carl's, and are nearly as good. Now, what is it that makes this album especially good? It's moody, and it has really good riffs. I don't know what inspired Bolt Thrower going into this album, but it's both darker sounding than the rest of their discography, and also has a lot of energy and quality songwriting. I don't know how to explain it, but this album just has an ominous, brutal vibe about it. It's uncannily expressive. And of course, good riffs are good riffs, no need to elaborate. The point is, this is Bolt Thrower firing on all cylinders. Contact Wait Out is arguably the best song on the album and has a good mix of slow, epic riffs and more energetic sections. Inside the Wire is more of a Melodeath song and is fairly catchy. Honor is notable for its slow, somber approach, making it more doom metal than death metal. Suspect Hostile is groovier, while Seventh Offensive is more mid-paced melodic. Valor, K-Machine, and A Hollow Truce are a string of shorter and more energetic songs, picking up the pace and providing some much-needed catchiness. Lastly, the album concludes with Pride, an epic, gratifying album closure that mixes everything the album previously contained. In conclusion, Honor, Valor, Pride is an amazing album, being expressive and interesting, as well as having very high-quality songwriting with plenty of variety. The production is amazing, and Dave and Martin are both fantastic on this album. I can't guarantee that you will like it, but I know I do. Honor, Valor, Pride is a 9 out of 10 and is Bolt Thrower's forgotten gem. By 2004, it had come time for another album, which Bolt Thrower was ready to record. However, Dave Ingram had to leave the band as he had health and personal issues that prevented him from continuing. Thankfully, Carl Willits was ready to return, so they proceeded with only a small delay. Their final and 8th album, and best album, was released in 2005. Those Once Loyal.
First time on stage after 12 years. What did you think in that moment? What did you feel when you got for the first time on stage again?
Just like a homecoming, really. It's the place where I feel really at home, and to get that buzz again, you know, to get that feeling back, it's something that you can't touch. You know, nothing on this planet can touch that feeling you get when you go on stage and perform our songs in front of people. It's just amazing. And you know, I think you can tell from our performances that we're loving it, absolutely loving it, every minute of it.
Those Once Loyal is Bolt Thrower's masterpiece, and one of the greatest death metal albums of all time, and perhaps even the best death metal album of its decade. It has pristine yet gritty production, amazing drumming from Kearns, the best of any Bolt Thrower album, Carl's best vocals ever, and the best guitar and bass playing of any Bolt Thrower album. The riff writing is also Bolt Thrower's best, as are the lyrics. The songs are shorter and to the point, but still melodic and methodical. Speaking of which, this album has much stronger groove elements and is also very melodic. Much more than their other albums, leading me to believe that it is arguably melodic death metal more than any other subgenre. This album has the best musicianship from all of its members, and it has the best songs, too. In particular are the following. At First Light and Entrenched are gritty, visceral songs with downright iconic riffs that provide an amazing start to the album. The Kill Chain, the last song with the Cenotaph riff, is also Bolt Thrower's biggest hit. Its main riff, however, is probably the catchiest riff in all of death metal, a riff that I am certain generated them much of their current fanbase, myself included. Anyways, the Kill Chain is god tier. The title track is a very epic sound of grandiose choruses and tremolo riffing, definitely one of Bolt Thrower's best songs. The album ends, however, perfectly. I couldn't ask for a better ending. The last song on Bolt Thrower's last album is their absolute best song, and one of the best death metal songs ever. When Cannons Fade. This song, at face value, seems like it has just simply amazing riffs and a bit of progression and an epic mood, but in fact, this song is incredibly cathartic, emotional, and haunting. It's full of energy and epicness in its first half, but when it gets to its final riff, and I'd say one of the best Bolt Thrower ever wrote, better than even the Kill Chain's riff, tears are sometimes summoned. It is the perfect conclusion to an utterly beautiful song. Anyways, Those Once Loyal is a masterpiece with Bolt Thrower at their absolute height, going out with their best song and their last riff being maybe their best. It gets without a doubt a 10 out of 10. This would be Bolt Thrower's last album. They tried making another album after it around 2008 or so, but realized they could never top Those Once Loyal and had nothing left to prove, so they remained a touring band only. This was until 2015 when tragedy struck. Martin Kearns abruptly died, and Bolt Thrower died with him. A year later in 2016, Bolt Thrower officially split up, not able to go on anymore. They did hint at attempting to make another album in his memory, but this has not yet happened. But that's okay. Bolt Thrower are and will likely always be, at least I think, the greatest death metal band of all time. They did pretty good. And best of all, they are finally getting the recognition and popularity they deserve. Before Martin died, they seemed to be a bit more niche, but nowadays everyone knows about them. And that is the silver lining to their tragic end. Thank you for making it to the end of my Bolt Thrower band review, a band that I'm very happy to be talking about. A bit of a somber ending there, but such is life. My ranking is on the screen now. Remember to peep my Patreon and Facebook pages, and to be voting in the polls I post so you can determine what bands I review. I appreciate comments, and subscribing is useful if you enjoy my content. That is all, I shall see you in my next video.
Insert digitally mapped virtual scan reveals Heart of War technology adapts location confirmed and concealed.